Welcome.
Oh
You
yeah,
get
nice to meet you.
nice to meet you. My name is, I guess my name's not here, but my name's Harvey. Let me share my slide. So just so you know, this thing is being recorded. So that's happening. But other than that, like, I mean, it's basically like a private session. So if you have any questions at any time, feel free to ask away.
Cool, sure. Yeah, I guess I'll mute for the presentation part just so that way if people are watching the recording.
Okay, sounds good. All right, so diving right into the presentation called The Golden Touch, 5 Tips to Transform Your Answer from Average to Outstanding. All right. Okay, so I've already, yes, seminar's recorded. I'll be providing information throughout, but we'll have my advertising packages at the end. And then if you have any follow-up questions, please reach out to me on accepttogether.com. A little bit about me. I am currently a second-year med student at Schulich. I did my undergrad at Western University. And fun fact, did a lot of things over the pandemic, but main things I got into were recording guitar covers, digital painting, and baking cheesecakes, a little bit of everything. Okay, so we're going right into, so I have 5 tips outlined here, and this will be useful to anyone, no matter what stage of interview prep you're in. So these are kind of tips I've accumulated through various interview sessions with clients, and just some of the more common things I've noticed in terms of what people can improve on. So I've listed 5 of them here. I'll go through all of them in this presentation. So our first one here is defining the term, and this is one that people tend to miss a lot just because it's not as obvious of a thing to do. So what do I mean by this is that when you get asked a question such as what does success mean to you, success is at the onset it can seem like, oh, it's pretty self-explanatory, but for people it can be actually quite different. So, you know, maybe success for one person means that they were able to finally do something for the first time, versus success for another person might be that they were able to achieve first place in a competition that they've been doing for many years. So for those two people, they're both successes, but in very different sense. So that's why it's important to always define the term if it's applicable. So I've listed just a few questions in which those where you have an opportunity to define the term. So what does success mean to you? What does taking initiative mean to you? Why was it your greatest failure? So so for these questions, like whenever they ask you something about, like, you know, one of your worst experiences or one of your greatest strengths, whenever they add those adjectives right before the question, that's a really good opportunity to define the term, because it also helps explain why it's so important. So, you know, maybe your greatest failure was not doing something because you just didn't have the courage to. And that separates it from other failures, because maybe other ones were you just didn't know what to do, or you didn't have the ability to do it, but your greatest failure was you knew you had the ability to do it, but you still didn't. So a lot of like nuances that you can get into here. So defining the term, it helps to contextualize the rest of your answer. So that means the audience will have a better understanding of where your answer is going and what it's coming from. All right, moving on. So what do we have next? Oops. Okay, so the second tip is identifying the theme. So this is kind of similar to the last one, where instead of defining the term, you're picking out a common theme. So this is more applicable for situational or ethical dilemma questions. And in this sense, it's, again, it's, you also use it at the beginning of your introduction, use it to set up the rest of your answer. So for situational ethical dilemma questions, oftentimes they're going to be asking about very common themes such as autonomy versus consent, you know, benefit of the group versus benefit of the individual, unmatched expectations resulting in conflict. So those are all very common themes that pop up in situational questions, such as, you know, if you're presented with a question like a 14-year-old patient presents to you asking for birth control pills, what would you do? A very, very like common ethical dilemma question. And like immediately, if you are able to identify the theme of it, which, you know, you can pick any of them, autonomy, consent, any of those, that really just shows, number one, that you can actually organize things quite well, and that you can, you know, despite all these details that are going on, you can pick out what's most important. And it also just shows kind of the medical knowledge side of things. So being able to identify, you know, some of the common pillars, such as like autonomy, beneficence, like justification, those things, those are all themes that can pop up in situational questions like those. All right. The third tip. So this is a very, very common mistake, in that when people talk about their answers, they talk a lot about the details and not enough about the lessons. And I think what's most important when you're interviewing is actually conveying what you learned from the situation or your experience, because people will have similar ECs. Like, you know, take an applicant who was VP events of some club. Another applicant will probably have the same thing. So what sets them apart is ultimately what they took away from the experience. And I think that one way to do this is essentially structuring your answer so that you're presenting your lesson first. So like, I learned the importance of maintaining bi-directional communication with my teammates, presenting your lesson first, and then using your EC or your experience to illustrate that lesson, to demonstrate how you learned it. So maybe it was like, I don't know, you're in the middle of like a tough basketball game, and you realize that your team was not playing very well because everyone is trying to do things on their own, and you know, took the team in for a huddle, and kind of talked to everyone and made sure that we're going to try and communicate with each other for the rest of the game. And that's like a very easy way to still incorporate your extracurricular experience, but frame it in the sense that you're talking about it in a lesson that you learned from it. So one thing I wrote down here is that you don't want to talk about everything you did in your experience, like all the details, the whole like process of an event or of an example, because ultimately you're not presenting a resume. That's all stuff that is probably included in your essays or in your other written applications. So what you really want to highlight with your interviewers is what you learned from the experience. All right. Tip number four. Okay, layered examples. What does this mean? Okay. So again, another common mistake that people run into is that they have very generic examples. And when I hear them, I'm like, okay, I'm trying to pick out the important stuff here, or I'm trying to see like how the example is relevant within the context of your extracurricular. And a lot of times the problem is because they're not specific enough. So, you know, going back to like a communication example, saying that you talked it out with your group members, or you communicated effectively with your team. Those are all very generic statements, and it doesn't tell me much about how you did those things. So always ask yourself when you're answering a question is, can you describe it more? So let's say, you know, I communicated well with my team members. What does that mean? Maybe I did, you know, I checked in with each of them individually and made sure that we were all meeting our goals to hit the deadline. That's much more specific than saying you communicated well with your team members. So Okay, I guess I have an example here as well. Again, it's really just to evaluate kind of what you're saying and making sure that you're providing specific enough evidence to show that, you know, you're able to, for example, inspire your teammates to be better. How did you inspire them? By getting everyone in for a team huddle, discussing what you can improve, you know, providing some pointers to players. Those are all very specific things that exist within your experience. You just have to mention those. And by doing that, you're able to show the skills that you developed from that experience, but also how it makes it a lot more personal. So it doesn't become a generic example anymore, but it's much more personalized. Like, you know, if you can describe it in this paragraph I have at the bottom of the screen, like I know that you're talking about it from a basketball experience, not from like a group project or something else. I know it's very specific to your experience there. All right. And tip number five, the oomph statement. So what does this mean? Okay. So this is kind of the conclusion piece of your interview answers, in that you want to connect it to a broader takeaway or the importance of that experience. It's very similar to like when like in high school, you learn the structure of an essay where you start out big, you narrow it down to your specific examples, and then you widen it out again. So it's similar in that sense. There's two ways you can do this. One, which is usually the one that I hear most often, is how will this skill or experience help you as a physician? Number two, which is I think a good alternative if you can't think of something for number one, is that how have you applied these lessons in the current moment or in like, you know, in current times? And this is a really good way to, especially if you're talking about an experience that happened maybe like a few years ago, to bring it back to the present and show your interviewers that you're still using those lessons, those takeaways that you learned from before. And that continuity, I think, is really important. And it's a good way to, again, demonstrate that, like, you know, you're always growing, you're always seeking improvement. So I think either of these scenarios, like pick one or the other, both is probably going to make your answer too long, but whichever one is more suitable is a good way to end off your interview answer. Okay, so that's the end of the tips I'm presenting, but just in terms of like what packages I offer. So interview prep, it's all listed on the left side here. So single interview sessions as well as bundles. So those are four sessions rather than one. And then on the right side, I have other packages, probably more relevant maybe later in the year. So for general consultations or application editing or review. And then I have the link to my profile just on the left-hand side of the screen there. Okay, that's the end of the presentation. Thanks for coming. And if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer.
No worries. Yeah, thanks for the presentation. So actually, yeah, so I guess just like, sorry, just give me a second. Okay, so I guess you did kind of cover this earlier, but I was wondering if you had any kind of tips or recommendations for preparing for those kind of personal questions or like kind of personal experience questions. Like I heard from other people usually kind of, I guess, prepare a few situations or scenarios, sorry, in your mind beforehand, and then that way you can kind of generalize them or adapt them to whatever the question is. But I don't know, like, would you recommend that as a good way, or any other tips regarding that?
Yeah, so for personal experiences, the basis of it is that the more you know, the better you're prepared for it. So like I did interview at Western, so they were like all panel, asked a lot of like personal questions. So how I prepared for that was I basically reviewed the ECs I wrote in preparation for Western, so like my abbreviated ABS. I looked at all the lessons I learned for like each of my important like EC experience. So like I think I had eight, like maybe, you know, my top eight EC experiences, reviewed the lessons I learned for each of those. So I knew them well. And then I practiced, I basically looked at very common interview questions like what's your greatest strength, or what's a challenge you overcame? So I looked at a bunch of those interview questions, and then under each question, I wrote like a point form outline of what I would say, like using an EC that I really wanted to highlight. So I think basically it was pretty much like I try and fit my EC under certain questions, but doing that practice, it also helps solidify that EC experience in your head. So if you have to talk about it again, you kind of know what to draw on because you've practiced it. Even if you get like a question that you didn't technically prepare for, but it's similar enough in that you can use those same lessons you learned and use that to answer the question. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that does. Thanks.
Yeah.
Kind of like a follow-up to that then, I guess, did you have any, sort of like volunteering experiences where it's more like community service or something like that? And if so, I don't know if you'd be willing to share, how did you talk about like those ones or in terms of like what you learned and stuff like that?
Yeah. So my volunteering and community service experiences, So in general, I try to structure my lessons around all the CanMeds rules. So like communicator, like leadership, professional, teamwork, things like that. So a lot of my lessons were structured around those roles. But I think what's unique about the community service ones is that you can probably throw in like the advocacy role in there. So especially if you've worked with certain organizations that are promoting, like mental health awareness or something. So those community service ones are a good way to talk about like advocacy lessons you learned.
Yeah, I see. Sorry, you mentioned the CanMed thing. Well, could you elaborate on that again? What was, I think I've heard about that before, but it's not quite sure.
Yeah. So CanMeds, you can just Google it as well, but it essentially lists, I think there's like six qualities of a physician that they list in there. And it's like a great resource in terms of finding things to write about. So some of the roles they have are like communicator, leader, I think collaborator might be like tied in with communicator, but essentially they're qualities of physicians. And those CanMeds roles are like integrated into like actual medical school curriculum to try and develop physicians with those qualities. So when you're like writing your apps or when you're answering your interview questions, like if you can structure your answers kind of around those CanMed roles and showing that, you know, you have some of these qualities that they're looking for, it's a really good base to to start off on and kind of extend your answers from there. So so it's a good resource to use when you're like writing your apps and all that.
I see. So about that, I'm actually this year I'm applying for dentistry. So I guess that's a little different, but I'm assuming probably the qualities are for the most part gonna be kind of overlapping, right?
Yeah, I would think so. I'm not sure if like dentistry also has a similar kind of profile or like that kind of thing, but you know, if you think about it, like dentistry, like healthcare profession, you're going to be like communicating with others, you're going to be leading a team, so honestly, like I would say you probably could still draw a lot of inspiration from it, even if it's not always as applicable as like it is to medical school, but It should be a lot of overlap, I would think.
Okay, great. Okay, just a question about your second point again regarding, or it was identify the theme. So for that one, I guess, do you mind giving like kind of a short example or something of how you would kind of structure your answer around that then, or?
Yeah, for sure. Let's go back to that slide. Okay. So I guess one example that I had brought up earlier was it was like 14-year-old patients seeking birth control. So that one, for example, there's I mentioned you can go down like autonomy or like consent for that route. So I would probably frame it in the sense where it's like, after you do your like short little intro, you can say something like, I think the main theme of this dilemma is the question of autonomy, and then dive into what that means. So like, as a 14-year-old patient, she or he or she has the right to take more control of their healthcare decisions. At the same time, I also have to evaluate whether or not they are capable or they are capable of understanding the information, the risks, and the benefits of the treatment, and whether they can apply that to their own situation. So basically, you kind of just illustrate, like, you can just like name drop the theme at the beginning and then dive into how you would address the situation from there. Does that make sense? Yeah. Another, like, very Or another like example, like a group versus individual example is could be like, you're working in a group project, and then suddenly one of your members has like been missing from the team for a number of weeks. Like, what would you do in this situation? So the theme is like, you can literally just say like group conflict or group versus individual conflict. So it doesn't have to be like a very specific thing that you have to draw on, but just mentioning a theme in general is usually a good way to set it up.
Right, okay, I see. Thanks.
No problem. Any other questions?
Sorry, I'm just looking at my notes again.
No worries.
I guess nothing right off the top of my head right now.
Okay. That's no problem. You've asked a lot. Okay.
I think that's okay for now. Yeah, thanks again.
Yeah, no
All
problem.
the
Thanks for
information.
coming.
Right.
All right. Take care.
Thanks. Have a good day.
Thanks. Bye.
Bye.